Hi, everybody. Welcome to Video Gold. Today, you'll meet one of the most talented musicians in the world, visit my first solo concert tour, and dive into the world of hip-hop rap. But first, let's go live to see what's got everybody jumping with a song from the Addicted to Jesus record called Holy Ghost Hop.
Are you ready to get up on your feet and do the Holy Ghost Hop with me here tonight? Pick up the bass there, Ray. Come on now. Everybody sing it. Everybody used to do the twist, the mashed potato, and it goes like this. The funky chicken, monkey too, wasn't nothing they would not do. But there's a new dance no one can stop, a leap for joy we call the Holy Ghost Hop. Now get ready, hold steady, don't deny it, just try it, be bold now, let it go now, get the Holy Ghost control now, rejoice.
I can rejoice in what God's given me. I can rejoice in times when I'm struggling. I can rejoice to know that God's going to pull me out. I can rejoice when things are going great because I know God put me there.
And I try to show love with other people. And that's rejoicing to me, to rejoice with other people when they're, you know, need a little help along the way.
The rejoicing is just, for me, it's praising Him. That's the exciting thing, is that when I praise Him, I feel so happy.
It's just an unbelievable release. I just feel so free and so encumbered. I don't even notice anybody around me. And I just start clapping and praising and lifting my hands up. And I just feel absolutely free.
We have such joy. I mean, it's just like you have to dance. You just have to get up and you have to dance and just praise Him.
In 1993, I was approached by a man named Jimmy Bowen. Now, Bowen was probably the biggest mover and shaker in the whole record industry. He made his mark producing artists like Frank Sinatra and Dean Martin in the 60s. But as of late, he was instrumental in putting country music on the map, producing artists like Barbara Mandrell, Hank Williams Jr., and George Strait. By the time he was president of Liberty Records, he was pretty well known for orchestrating one of his clients rise to the top of the music scene. That artist was Garth Brooks, one of music's biggest artists ever. Now, Bowen came to one of my concerts and told me his vision of selling Christian music not only in Bible bookstores, but in every major secular store in the world. He wanted me to sign to Liberty, and he would in turn purchase a Christian company. I told him I wasn't interested in crossing over to secular music. Jesus would always be the centerpiece of my music. He said that's exactly what he wanted as well. So, we signed a deal, and then we're off and running at a new level. The first record we were going to do was a best of with one new song. He asked me who I would want to produce it. I guess I was waiting to see if he could exercise some recording industry muscle, so I just pulled the biggest name out of the hat I could think of, David Foster. Foster had produced more hit records than anybody alive. He was the Steven Spielberg of music. He produced all the Chicago albums, Celine Dion's When I Fall in Love, and at the time, his most recent hit, I Will Always Love You by Whitney Houston. Phone didn't blink. He made a couple of phone calls, and the next thing I know, I was in the studio with David Foster. I wrote a song just for the record that I felt capsulized at that time 15 years of ministry. We became good friends. He also agreed to play the piano on the video as well. His production was powerful and passionate. So from the record, The Absolute Best, here's probably one of the most meaningful songs the Lord has ever given me, simply called Serve the Lord.
Jesus Christ, His only Son, and the blessed Holy Spirit, distinct yet three in one. I believe there is forgiveness for everything we've done. That is why all the more I will serve Him. I believe the Son of God was crucified upon the tree, laid within a borrowed tomb, not far from Calvary. I believe He rose up from the dead, alive for all to see. That is why all the more I will serve Him. I have made my decision. I have staked my claim. I have drawn a line in the sand, and I'll not be ashamed. With the world behind me and the cross before, by the grace of God, I will serve the Lord. I believe you must be born again. John 3:16 is true. The old life can be washed away, everything made new. I believe the love of God can somehow find its way to you. That is why all the more I will serve Him. I have made my decision. I have staked my claim. I have drawn a line in the sand, and I'll not be ashamed. With the world behind me and the cross before, by the grace of God, I will serve the Lord. And I know when Satan and his minions come to torment me, when I invoke the name of Jesus, every demon has to flee. I know the time will come when Christ returns again someday. Till then, there's just one name on earth whereby men can be saved. I believe there is a right and wrong, a time to live and die, and the Bible is the blueprint that all men should live by. I believe I'm not alone with my faith in Jesus Christ. That is why all the more we will serve Him.
We have made our decisions. We have stayed. Serving God for me means you've got to give everything. You've got to, every single day, every minute of the day, be ready to do anything that God puts in front of you.
And it's a decision every day. Some people think, well, you go down and you made a decision for Christ and it's a one-time decision. I believe when we first confess Christ into our heart that we become born again, but it's a daily decision to serve Him.
There are times when you don't feel like serving and you have to keep your feet and your hands saying, Lord, these are yours. You fill them. You help me serve. There are other times when serving is a real joy, and then it's exciting.
You've got to live it. You've got to know it. You've got to believe it, and have convictions that channel your life. And those convictions, of course, come from the Word of God.
It's vitally important to know what you believe, especially when you're out there in the secular world interacting with people who want to know, hey, what are you about? What are you living for? As the scripture says, to be able to give an answer to them.
God doesn't beat you over the head. He puts a call in your life. He asks you to serve Him, but He's a loving God. He doesn't want robots. He wants people that choose to serve Him with their whole life.
Back in 1982, I was invited to sing at the Christian Artists Music Seminar in Estes Park, Colorado. It was a major Christian music industry gathering. I only had time to do one or two songs in the afternoon session. Little did I know, Bill Gaither was in the audience. And for those of you that don't know, the Bill Gaither Trio was the biggest concert draw in Christian music at the time. Being on his tour meant success was right around the corner. Many other artists got their start by being premiered with Bill Gaither. Sandy Patty, Amy Grant, Steve Green, and even White Hart was his backup group. Bill liked my songs because he said they were funny and different. Then he asked me the big question, would you like to go on tour with me this fall? And I, of course, gave him the big answer, absolutely yes. Well, here's one of the songs he heard that day that started the whole ball rolling. From the Sundays on the Way record, here is God Don't Care What the Circumstance.
Let's put a little song together that says, God don't care what the circumstance. Or even if the future's looking dim, God don't want some big old song and dance. He just wants your faith and trust in Him. You're clapping on my solo there. See, you missed it. Now it's gone. That solo's gone. Think about old Noah sitting on his front porch, eating lasagna that he cooked with a torch. He was halfway through a meatball when the Lord spoke. He said, boy, you're going to be busy for a while, building an ark from a huge wood pile. Old Noah's eyes got big as baseballs, and he almost choked. Well, he told his family what was going down, and they listened intently to him. And nobody fought or fussed or frowned, because nobody knew how to swim. When the rains came, they was all safe inside, and they didn't get wet or nothing. Noah obeyed, because when God speaks, everybody listens, even E.F. Hutton.
God don't get what the circumstance. Or even if the future's looking dim, God don't want some big old song and dance. He just wants your faith and trust in Him.
Thank you. a little Egyptian music.
Crazy.
Now, some people think you could actually be too young to be used of God. You believe that? So I want to dedicate this next verse to all those here between the ages of 13 and 19. Okay? Little David must have just been in his teens when he faced Goliath of the Philistines. He was armed with just a slingshot and some stones. Now Goliath was a giant and strong as a tank, and when he looked at men, their stomach sank. And there stood little David all alone. With faith in God, he flung his sling, and much to their surprise, he killed that monster with a stone and nailed him between the eyes. Then decapitated his fallen foe and made sure he was dead, and showed everyone there he was someone who really knew how to get ahead. God don't care what the circumstance, or even if the future's looking dim. God don't want some big old song and dance, he just wants your faith and trust in him. We're a very spiritual group here tonight. I got one more. Now, old David, he got messed up every once in a while, you know what I mean? But he still came through, and this was one of the times where he really showed up. King David was smitten down to his socks when his eyes caught that Bathsheba fox. I just write him the way God gives it to me, all right? His resistance was so shook that he backslid. He went and had her husband killed, thinking his dreams would be fulfilled, but God would make him wish that he never did. The Lord punished him severe for being stupid as an ape. But David's faith was strong, and God soon pulled him back in shape. Now there's a lesson to be learned here about dealing with temptation. You keep your eyes on the Creator, man, and not on his creation. What the circumstance, or even if the future's looking dear. Well, my God, he don't want some big old song and dance. He just wants your faith and trust. He just wants your faith and trust. He just wants your faith and trust in it.
Spring of 1990, I was in the studio working on a new record which I didn't have a title for, when I found myself hanging out with Toby McKeon. He's the lead singer of the group that was making shockwaves in contemporary Christian music at the time, called DC Talk. We were throwing ideas back and forth about songs, and I threw out an idea for a title. He liked it, and we immediately started talking about recording together. So in the summer of 1990, not only was some good music made, but a friendship was formed as well. DC Talk has gone on to become probably one of contemporary Christian music's greatest groups ever. And I wonder if they still remember me. I don't know. Well, anyway, here's Toby, Kevin, Mike, and myself singing the title track from the Addicted to Jesus record called, what else? Addicted to Jesus.
Give me an E. You know it. Give me an S-U-S. You know. Boys, what is this spell? What am I saying? What's going down?
Your feet. for me, you know, being addicted to Jesus is just a recognition that, you know, I need him more than food or water or, you know, people or anybody.
Everything I view is viewed through looking at Christ. Would it be pleasing to him?
It's a 24-hour day constant intake of the Word of God and the ways of God so that you can live the life of God.
To be addicted with Jesus is a tremendous joy and peace and taking every place that you go, share him every place that you go. You got to give it the ultimate experience to somebody else. If you keep it to yourself, you're selfish.
You either will be addicted to something of the world or you'll be addicted to the person who created you.
The way to get there, I think, is through some of the basic disciplines that Christ talks about. You know, the fasting, prayer, scripture study, time alone with God in solitude.
This life is something going through my veins all the time. And the thing is, I don't have to shovel it, I don't have to snore it, I don't have to do anything. I just have to lift my hands and say, Jesus, come in. And he's right there.